Now for our final section of population genetics, I want to bring together a lot of different ideas, and we're going to use a simple mathematical model to try to characterize where populations might be evolving and where they might not be evolving. So first we want to have a sense of what it would take for gene frequencies to stay the same from one generation to the next. If gene frequencies stayed the same, we would say that the population was showing a genetic equilibrium. Things are balanced somehow, and nothing changes from one generation to the next. Now, for this to happen, we need large population size. And that's actually just the flip side of the founder effect. If you have a small population, you can get sudden shifts just by chance. But in a very large population, gene frequencies are not expected to move around at random. Secondly, is if we see random mating. If we're not showing any kind of mating preferences that exclude certain genotypes, then again, the genes can all be kind of enfolding on themselves one generation after the next. Third is if the mutation rate is really, really low, so that's not going to be a source of change. Fourth is that there's no gene flow between populations. And finally, that all genotypes reproduce equally. That means there's no natural selection going on. Conversely, there are all these factors that could disrupt genetic equilibrium. Any one of these will cause gene frequencies to change from one generation to the next, as we've seen: genetic drift, non-random mating, high mutation rates, gene flow, and non-random reproduction, in other words, where there is a great deal of natural selection. In observing patterns in real populations, it's often a very important question to know if a population is actually currently evolving. And we can take this concept of genetic equilibrium versus disequilibrium or genetic change to make some very simple predictions. In the absence of any kind of evolution or evolutionary change, the distribution of genotypes, that is, homozygotes of either the dominant or recessive or the heterozygotes, can be predicted from allele frequency. And this can be done through what's called the Hardy-Weinberg equation, which provides a null model, or kind of a simplistic view of the way the world is in the absence of any kind of evolution at all. So we're going to be looking specifically at circumstances where there's nothing interesting going on. Gene frequency is going to stay the same from one generation to the next. So we're going to have to do a little bit of algebra here. And we just have two variables here. It's actually a very simple equation. And by convention, we're going to use the letter P to represent the frequency of the dominant allele. At any given locus, when we're looking at Hardy-Weinberg, we imagine there's only two alternative alleles, and the frequency of the dominant allele is given by P. And since there's only one other allele, that's the remainder. The remainder then would be Q. That's the frequency of the recessive allele. So P is the frequency of the dominant allele, Q is the frequency of the recessive. Now, if we imagine that we have a genotype in a population that consists of these two alternative alleles, capital A and little a, and we see that in the population there's a proportion that are homozygous capital A, that's going to be because in the maternal side of the population, capital A was present amongst all the females with frequency P. And from the father, also with frequency P. So given that there's some percentage in the overall population of the dominant allele, it should be the same in the men and the women, males and the females. And so the chances of producing a homozygote for that particular genotype is simply the probability of getting it from the mother times the probability of getting it from the father. So that's P squared. You can be a heterozygote, and the probability of getting the heterozygote where the dominant allele comes from the mother and the recessive allele comes from the father is P times Q. A is the remainder, and that's Q. And so it's P times Q, probability of being a heterozygote because you got the dominant from the mom and the recessive from the dad. There's also a proportion P times Q where you're heterozygote and you got the dominant allele from your dad and the recessive from the mom. Okay? And to be recessive homozygote, there's a chance Q of getting that A allele from the mom times same probability from the dad, and that's Q squared. So the point is that there are four ways that you can end up with a particular genotype in the next generation. You can either be homozygous for the dominant, and that's P squared, homozygote for the recessive, Q squared, and there's two different ways you can be heterozygote, and so that's 2PQ. And the key thing here is that these three terms add up to 1 or to 100%, because these are the only possibilities you can have, and they must add up to 100%. So let's take an actual example, and I'm going to walk you through the idea of Hardy-Weinberg. So we've seen snapdragons before. I like them because phenotype equals genotype. If we go into a field of snapdragons and we count out 100 different plants, and we find one white snapdragon in a field of 100, 18 that are pink, and 81 that are red, okay? We can take that information and we can play around with it. We can have fun with Hardy-Weinberg. So, first thing we want to do is to calculate the allele frequencies. So, we have 81 red plants, 18 pink, and one white. There's 100 diploid individuals, so they're contributing 200 alleles to this overall gene pool. So there are 81 that are red. They're homozygous for the capital R allele. So that equals 162 capital R alleles, because they each have two. So 81 times 2 is 162. And they're contributing no little r alleles. The 18 heterozygotes, so there's 18 more capital R alleles there. And now we've also got 18 little r alleles. We just have one white, so that has two copies of little r allele, so we get two copies of little r. So out of our 200 alleles, we have 180 of them that are the dominant capital R allele, and only 20 that are the recessive little r allele. So we can then use that to calculate the allele frequency. And so it's 180 out of the total 200. So 90% of the alleles in this gene pool are the capital R allele, and only 10% are little r. So P is equal to 0.9, and Q is equal to 0.1. Okay. Now again, let's think about what would happen if all of those alleles are just mixing around at random, okay? If the allele frequencies are P is equal to 0.9 and Q is equal to 0.1, what's the expected frequency of each genotype in the population? So 90% of the alleles that would be coming in from the mother's eggs are the capital R allele, only 10% are the little r allele. Likewise, in all the potential sperm that could fertilize all these eggs, 90% of them are going to possess the capital R, only 10% the little r. Okay? So remember we did this with the Punnett squares where we knew families, and we set up, you know, that you're going to have a certain proportion with capital R, a certain with little r, da-da-da-da. We get the heterozygotes that are pink, homozygotes red, homozygotes white. But now we're actually going to put in a probability here that comes from our calculation of allele frequency. So yeah, from this parent's side, 90% of the alleles coming in are capital R. Only 10% are little r, okay? So if we substitute those numbers in and simply do the math, a 90% chance of getting one here times a 90% chance here, 81% of the offspring genotypes should be homozygous capital R. 1% should be the recessive, and 9 plus 9, 18% should be heterozygotes. Okay? So that's 81%, 18%, and 1%. Okay? So, in the absence of selection or anything else, it's boring, 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 nothing is going on, The proportion of genotypes should remain constant from one generation to the next. This is what Hardy-Weinberg is assuming. Okay? So if we start out with generation one, like we saw in our field, that 81% are red, 18% are pink, 1% are white, then all of those eggs and sperm meeting at random, but there's 9 times as many capital R as little r, next generation will produce the same, 81% red, 18% pink, 1% white. On and on forever, boring, okay? Nothing's happening, there's no evolutionary change, okay? But the point is, we can predict these genotypes, the distribution of these different types. All we had to know was the allele frequency, one generation after the next being the same. This is going on. If this is true, then we're making a lot of assumptions about what's happening in this population. It follows Hardy-Weinberg. 81% red, 18% pink, 1% white. Nothing is happening to cause any change in gene frequency or the distribution of these different genotypes from one generation to the next. Okay, now let's do a little journey. Let's go outside and let's go visit another field of snapdragons. And now we're going to find we have something quite different. Let's say we count up the different kinds of flowers, the different plants. We have 35 red flowering plants, 30 pink, and 35 white. Okay? So let's work out the allele frequencies again. So these 35 red are contributing 70 capital R alleles. These 30 pink are contributing number 30. So there's 100 red alleles in this population, in this gene pool. And we're getting the same from the white. 30 single copies of R, 35 two copies of little r. So again, that adds up to 100. Okay? Now in this case, the allele frequency is 0.5 for red and 0.5 for white. So P is equal to 0.5 and Q is equal to 0.5. Now, let's do Hardy-Weinberg. We should predict that we should get P squared, so 0.5 squared, there should be 25 red snapdragons. There should be 2PQ, P is equal to 0.5, Q is also equal to 0.5, so 2 times that, 2PQ is equal to 0.5 times 100, there should be 50 pink. And then there should be Q squared, 0.5 squared, gives us 25 white. So we should have seen the ratio of 25 red, 50 pink to 25 white. How does that compare to what we saw here? What we see is that there aren't very many pink. If this population of flowers is truly following Hardy-Weinberg, there should be 2 pink for each red. There should be 2 pink for each white. But that's not what we saw. We saw more red than pink and more white than pink. That's not following Hardy-Weinberg, okay? So just by having this very simple null model, this Hardy-Weinberg, we can say, whoa, wait a minute, this is not following the assumptions of Hardy-Weinberg. That means the assumptions are wrong in this particular case. What could it be? It could be disruptive selection. Say there's something wrong with being pink, okay? Red flowers are healthier on a bright sunny day and white flowers are better during the full moon. Something like that. Who knows? But they might have an advantage, whereas the intermediate form has a disadvantage. It could be there's assortative pollination. Maybe when a bee goes to a red flower, I want to find another red flower, and it goes from red flower to red flower to red flower. Another bee that goes to a white flower goes, I want to go white flower to white flower. Okay? That would tend to cause red pollen to end up on red flowers, thus having red offspring, white flower, white pollen, white offspring, and that would separate things out. So Hardy-Weinberg is not being met because it assumes everything is random. That's not random. So the point of doing this, and the reason people go through this little exercise with Hardy-Weinberg, is to get a sense of whether a population is evolving or whether it's in some sort of genetic equilibrium. In almost every case, there's almost always examples of genetic change in areas where the environment is changing, where the climate is changing. And so then the next step would be to say, well, okay, what's actually happening? What's causing this change? So Hardy-Weinberg is used as a very simple tool to get a beginning description of whether there is evolution or not in a natural population.